quiet, numbskulls. I'm broadcasting.
The medical marijuana. The medical marijuana. The medical marijuana. Whoa, 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 why, yeah, the medical. It's the medical marijuana show. You knew we know.
Good evening again, everybody. This is Medical Marijuana Radio for a Saturday night, the 7th of December, right here on the Time for Hemp Global Broadcasting Network, on medicalmarijuanaradio.com, on iHeartRadio, on Spreaker, on YouTube. We're all over the place. And tonight, tonight's guest will be Jonathan Walker. We're going to talk about his Kickstarter campaign and a project called After Legalization, and we'll do that around 20 after the hour, well, 20 minutes into the show. But first, as always, if you're going to find the strains that you want here in New Mexico, you've got to shop around.
You better shop around. Oh, yeah, you better shop around.
And right here in Albuquerque, Canaceutics this week are going to have the following: White Widow, Chem Dog, Kosher Kush, Super Lemon Haze, those are two of my favorites, Zero Gravity, OG18, Four Corners, and Shit. And that is Canaceutics. Over at CG Corrigan, coming up this week, their indicas will be God's Gift, Northern Lights, and LA Confidential. Their high CBD strains will be Atota Madre and Canna Tonic. Their sativa dominants are Deadhead, Cinderella 99, and Blue Dream. Over at MedZen, they're going to have ESD, ATF, which is Alaskan Thunderfuck, Super Lemon Haze, Big Bang, Kahuna Shark, Trainwreck, Hash Skunk, Hindu Kush, and Critical. Again, that's MedZen. Over at New Mexican, get this, everybody, they have some plants for sale. They have a Northern Lights plant, 2.6 feet tall. And indica, it's $175. These are all ready to flower. They have something called KA420, a 5-foot-tall plant. And they have, I guess that's a sativa harlequin hybrid. That's $225. They have two of those KA420s. Of course, you must have a personal production license to purchase the plants. Give them a call. They have available for bud and flower this week: OG Kush, Raspberry Kush, Shiva Skunk, White Shark, CBD AK-47, CBD Critical Mass, and that's from New Mexican. They also have available from G&G Genetics at New Mexican, Wonder Cream, Buddha's Sister, Blue Moonshine, and Lambo. And that's, again, G&G Genetics available at New Mexican. Now, over at New Mexico Top Organics, their bud will be Blue Dream and New Mexi Confidential and Recon. Their BHO wax will be Banana Kush, Blue Dream, Indica Blend, Oracle, RX, and White Widow. Once again, that's New Mexico Top Organics. And now, some news. That's right, we've got news, and this is from leafscience.com. Marijuana could reduce brain damage after a stroke, researchers say. This is from December 3rd, just a few days ago. New research suggests compounds in marijuana may protect the brain from damage following a stroke. Scientists hope to perform human trials in the near future. Researchers at the University of Nottingham conducted a meta-analysis of previous studies, reports the Nottingham Post, concluding that cannabinoids could reduce the severity of a stroke as well as improve neurological outcomes. Lead author, Dr. Tim England, honorary consultant, a stroke physician at the University of Nottingham and Royal Derby Hospital, presented the findings at this week's annual UK Stroke Forum conference. Dr. England explained in a university release that while researchers thus far have been limited to animals, the latest findings provide support for human studies. And this is a quote: "The meta-analysis of preclinical stroke studies provides valuable information on the existing and importantly missing data of the use of cannabinoids as a potential treatment for stroke patients. The data are guiding the next steps in experimental stroke in order to be able to progress onto initial safety assessments in a clinical trial," end quote. Dr. England and his team examined 94 past studies involving the effect of various cannabinoids on 1,022 rats, mice, or monkeys, reports the New Zealand Herald. The effects on stroke seem to be consistent across all three types of cannabinoids: synthetic, marijuana-derived, and those naturally produced by the body. Dr. Dale Webb, director of the research and information at the Stroke Association, also concluded that scientists should now aim to replicate the findings in humans. And here's his quote from Dr. Webb: "The findings have identified the potential for cannabinoids to reduce brain damage caused by stroke. Further research is needed to investigate whether cannabinoids have the same effects in humans. The effects of cannabinoids on the brain are highly complex, and it remains a risky substance." Following the presentation of the findings, Dr. Medina Kara, a neuroscientist at the Stroke Association, said that human trials are now under discussion. Now, we're all interested in testing our cannabis. We don't want residual solvents and residual pesticides and so forth. So there's a new testing method, and this is from medicaljane.com. New cannabis testing methodology being developed in Connecticut, one of the new states for medical. New Haven University is developing new contaminant tests. A team of researchers at New Haven University are developing a new methodology to test for contaminants in a given batch of cannabis. They hope to make it faster and easier for lab testing facilities across the country to identify potentially harmful substances. The school previously received a $100,000 grant from the Federal Office of the National Drug Control Policy's High Intensity Drug Trafficking Areas Program. The new project comes as an extension of the law enforcement related marijuana DNA profiling the school has done over the last 5 years. Heather Miller Coyle, a forensic botanist and associate professor at New Haven, leads the research team. She points out that there are a number of microscopic particles that may contaminate a sample of cannabis: mold, mildew, insect parts, salmonella, and E. coli, to name a few. In turn, Coyle and her students are developing a method for screening cannabis as it utilizes DNA profiling and analysis to check biological contaminants. They will then compare the DNA profiles to those of organisms kept in a database maintained by the National Institute of Health. New testing method would use DNA to screen cannabis. It is no secret that cannabis testing facilities have grown immensely in the time since Steep Hill opened the first lab of its kind in Oakland, California. With that said, these facilities rarely follow the same procedures. This can cause discrepancies between the testing locations and a great deal of uncertainty as far as patients are concerned. Further, contaminant testing is not yet required in a number of medical marijuana states, including California. Coyle believes that testing is absolutely necessary. I agree. If there's no certification, it's like saying that we don't check our meat for mad cow disease, she explained. That's our goal as a private university, to develop the tools to address the or mediate this issue. Mason Tvert, communications director for the Marijuana Policy Project, noted that no recorded death to date has been attributed to cannabis alone. However, health effects of marijuana tainted with mold, pesticides, and other contaminants are unclear. Although we have not seen significant problems with tainted marijuana in the past, we should certainly be taking steps to make sure it is not a problem in the future, Tvert said. Coyle hopes to have the project ready for next summer, according to the Daily Chronicle. When ready, New Haven University may either patent or the methodology and license it for a fee or open up a testing lab of their own. Okay, what else do I have for you here? Okay, here's a good one. Okay. New study finds cannabis may prevent erectile dysfunction caused by high cholesterol. An interesting new study published by the Journal of Clinical and Developmental Immunology and the National Institute of Health has found that activation of the body's cannabinoid receptors, something done naturally by cannabis, can actually reduce the risk of erectile dysfunction in those with hypocholesterolemia. According to the study's researchers, hypocholesterolemia, which is the presence of high levels of cholesterol in the blood, is one of the most important risk factors for erectile dysfunction, mostly due to the impairment of oxidative stress and endothelial function in the penis. Did I say a bad word? I hope not. After studying the effects of cannabinoid receptor activation on mice with high cholesterol, researchers found that CB2 activation decreased histological features, which are associated with erectile dysfunction in high cholesterol mice. According to the study's lead researcher, these results have important implications that could lead to cannabinoids and cannabis being used to treat erectile dysfunction, which affects over 30 million Americans. The study, which can be found, you can go to thejointblog.com you can click here and you can actually read the actual study. It's the first of its kind. Okay. Now, I'm trying to see if I can get back on schedule here. I think I'll take a little break right now and play a little tune, then we'll come back with our guest. So we will be right back after this.
I'm going crazy, but I know all along the time. Hi, this is Steve D'Angelo, and you are listening to Medical Marijuana Radio.
The Medical Marijuana. The Medical Marijuana Radio. Radio.
Okay, we're back, and I'm going to get our guest on the line, Jonathan, right now. Hi, Jonathan. Hi, John, can you hear me? Hello, hello. You're live on Medical Marijuana Radio. I'm not hearing Jonathan. Great.
Hello.
Jonathan, can you hear me? This is Larry. Welcome to the show. Jonathan? Hang on. Hi, Jonathan. This is Larry. Welcome to the show. Can you hear me?
Hello?
Hi. Yes, I hear you. I guess he's not hearing me. Headphones. Hi. Can you hear me? Jonathan. Oh, boy. It's one of those days, folks. I do hear Jonathan. I do see him. But he's not hearing me. Jonathan, let's try again. Let's try this again here. Hi, Jonathan, can you hear me?
Hello. Hello.
Hi, yes, Jonathan, welcome to Medical Marijuana Radio. Are you there? He's not hearing me. I do hear him. Wonderful. Jonathan. Jonathan.
I can't hear you.
You can't hear me. Okay.
On the phone.
Well, I think... okay, do you want to reboot your Skype?
Sorry. It's not working.
Okay. I'm going to try your telephone.
Not hearing her.
Okay, I'm going to call your phone. Hang on. Let's try it this way, folks. Live radio. How much fun is this? Call phone. Hang on, folks. Let's try the phone. See what happens. Jonathan? John?
Hello?
Hi, can you hear me, Jonathan? Still nothing. Okay.
Hello?
No, I guess not. Let's try this other... This is crazy, man. This is going to be a great show, folks. A lot of fun for me. I want to do this. 908. See what this is like.
Hello?
Jonathan, this is Larry. Welcome to Medical Marijuana Radio. I guess your Skype wasn't working, but can you hear me now?
Yes, I can. Sorry about that. I don't know what's going on.
I was able to see and hear you, but you weren't hearing me. But anyway, welcome to Medical Marijuana Radio. And I found you on the internet a couple of days ago, and I thought it was very interesting what you're doing. So why don't you tell us what's going on with After Legalization?
Yeah, so I've written a book, After Legalization. We're doing a Kickstarter to get it published right now. You can go to Kickstarter, look for After Legalization, under John Walker. Basically, I'm writing the book about how marijuana after it's legalized will likely be treated. And I'm doing this sort of for two reasons. One, when you demystify things, people are more willing to accept it. You know, there's a polling that shows if you say, should marijuana be legal, it doesn't get as much support if you say, should marijuana be legal and regulated and taxed like alcohol.
Okay.
If it gives people an idea of what it's going to be like, they're more supportive. And the other thing is there's just all sorts of, you know, decisions we have to make about how you treat legal marijuana. And, you know, we really should be thinking about it now, because once those decisions get made, you know, inertia really takes over. And it becomes a lot more difficult to change the system than build a good system to start with.
So what are you seeing now, you know, while you're developing this project, as far as Colorado and Washington are concerned? You've probably read their rules and regs, that what they're trying to do. So what do you see that jumps out at you as being maybe on the wrong path?
You know, there's a few things. The inability to grow at home in Washington State.
Right.
You know, that I consider to be the wrong path right there. You know, there's very little reason people shouldn't be allowed to grow at home. People brew beer at home, or people at least have the option to. Very few people do it. So one of the big concerns with growing at home in Washington State is they're afraid it would, you know, undercut the tax revenue they're bringing in. But if we look at things like, you know, home brewing, you know, very few people do it. So it's not really undercutting the tax scene of beer.
Right. I do think you're right about that. And also, just because you might be allowed to grow doesn't mean that you're going to grow and that you're going to be successful with it. I'll give you an example. Here in New Mexico, where you can be licensed to grow your own medical marijuana, you know, a whole, let's see, I almost 40-something percent of the 10,000 patients have grow licenses, but I'm going to guess that less than 15% are actually growing, because it's not easy. So I think the numbers are probably wrong with some of the estimates, but obviously growing your own, I don't think it's going to take too much taxes away, again, because most people want to go to a dispensary and they don't have the time or knowledge to grow.
Yeah, I've heard an interesting statistic. Apparently, in Europe, amongst intensive, you know, marijuana users, those are, you know, referred to in the study, the Netherlands has the lowest rate of home growing. You know, it's easy to purchase marijuana. Most people choose to do that. Only about 5% of sort of regular marijuana users choose to grow marijuana at home there.
Right, and
you know,
I think
other states where it's tough to buy, you know, you're more inclined to, you know, put that extra work in. But if it's
right,
easy to buy, most people like to go buy.
Now, in Amsterdam, is it just the visitors that are only allowed to have 5 grams, or are the locals also on that restriction? Do you know?
Let's see. I believe that you are. It's weird how it's worked, because it's more of a non-enforcement as opposed to like an actual rule, I believe.
Uh-huh.
The way the law's treated there.
All right, well, let's get back to your project, okay? Is this a book or a documentary? What is the media that you're going to be using?
This is a book. I've been working on it for about the past year and a half now, and I've basically finished the writing aspect of it. You know, I need to hire someone to go through and do the editing, you know, copy editing and stuff, fact-checking. You know, there's some, you know, 180 references that all need to be cross-checked, you know, in figures. I mean, you know, then it needs to be formatted and printed and stuff. But hopefully, because the actual sort of writing aspect, which is the most difficult, is all done, with people's support, I can have it out very quickly, you know, basically at the beginning of next year when the legal sales start in Colorado.
So
sort of what the time frame I was aiming for.
So your project, it's self-publishing, and that's why you're having the Kickstarter?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, obviously, you're studying both Washington and Colorado, so without offending one or the other, who do you think is more on track?
Well, they've been you know, putting it in place a lot quicker in Colorado, and I just in general prefer the Colorado's model. You know, it's slightly less restricting. You know, both are very restrictive systems, you know, compared to how theoretically it can be treated. But, you know, they allow home growing in Colorado. They, they have a slightly lower tax in Colorado, or a significantly lower tax in Colorado. It's still a high tax, but nowhere near as high as Washington State's. You know, those are two sort of the biggest things that would stand out for a regular person.
I know that they're rewriting rules all the time. They had a fight with the City Council of Denver last week about whether you can actually smoke your legal cannabis on your front porch, and they were against it, and then they realized that that wasn't going to be too good for anybody, and they changed their minds on that. So there's like little tweaks, and I think, you know, for the next 10 years with new states coming on board, these recreational programs and medical programs are going to have to be tweaked because we're all learning on the fly.
Well, yeah, but it's a constantly evolving process. Like, if you look, you know, the closest comparison is the end of prohibition in this country. And, you know, we're still basically unwinding prohibition in this country. There are some, you know, 8% of the country is still dry counties.
Right.
You
are you talking about dry counties? Are you talking about alcohol?
Yeah, alcohol, dry counties.
Dry counties. There's 8% of the counties in the United States that are dry. Well, you know, that's... has it been changing, or has it just been holding at that?
No, it's been slowly going down. Uh-huh. You know, they recently passed a law in Mississippi a few years back where individual towns, you know, it used to be each county had to decide if they were going to become wet. And they passed a law that allowed individual towns within dry counties to become wet. So it's been like a real slow, steady process, but, you know, it's been going on for decades now. You know, they only approved brewing beer at home in Alabama 5 months ago. You know, up till then, you could not brew beer at home.
Uh-huh. Interesting. Well, there's a lot of, you know, weird stuff, weird old laws on the books. You know, some things that we do every day with our wives and girlfriends are illegal in some states. So, you know, there's a lot of old, antiquated laws on the books. Let me give out the numbers in case anybody would like to join the conversation here. In New Mexico, 505-514-0098. In the 575 area, 5194-MMJ. In Arizona, 623-3994-MMJ. California, 818-8500-MMJ. And, of course, you can Skype us at MMJ Radio. So, next, I guess in 2014, there's going to be some other states that are going to try to legalize for adults. Who do you think has the best chance of it happening, or do you think a lot of them will?
So there seems to be a decent effort underway in Alaska and Oregon for 2014. So, you know, if it makes it on the ballot in any state, it's most likely going to be one of those two. And then it looks like the groups, for the most part, are really organizing around 2016. That's when we'll probably see a bunch of initiatives all over the country.
What about California? Are they on for 2014, or are they waiting until 2016?
There are some individual groups pushing for 2014, but it is really hard and real expensive to get on the ballot in California. Mm-hmm. So there's no groups that really have the sort of big money behind it that's usually necessary to get the, you know, several hundred thousand signatures needed. But it looks like they're planning, or they're sort of like building the groundwork to do in 2016. And that's a presidential year, you know, higher youth turnout.
Right.
That usually means about 2-3% better for marijuana initiatives.
Right. The advocates say to do it during the presidential election years. But obviously, you know, why wait if you can get it on in 2014 and it doesn't cost a lot? I mean, if you get it on in 2014 and it doesn't pass, you got 2 years to regroup and get it going again. Are you also involved with medical or just legalization?
We at Justin and I, we do promote medical marijuana. Or, you know, we do promote changing basically all drug laws, you know, for the better. You know, that includes, you know, everything from sentence reform on non-marijuana to promoting medical marijuana laws in states that don't have it.
We have a caller from 505-716. You're on the air.
Hi, it's Nurse Heather.
Hey, Nurse Heather. Hi, how are you? We're on with John Walker, and he's talking about after legalization. He's got a Kickstarter project. Heather, I know that you want to, I want you to tell me a little bit about your experience the other day, but I want to do that after the break. Heather, any comment right now on John and his project on what's going to happen and how cannabis will be treated after legalization?
You know, to be honest with you, I wasn't listening to the show. I just now called in. I couldn't get on.
Oh, yeah. Well, actually, this is the time I asked you to call in, but the network had a we had a false start. I had to start the show over again. So here, what I'm going to do right now, I'm going to figure out how to put both of you on hold, and then I'm going to take a break. And then after the break, in 4 minutes, I'll come back and we'll talk to John again. We'll finish up with him, and then you'll tell us your story about what happened in Arizona. So, guys, hang on, and we'll be right back in about 4 minutes. Thank you.
It's all about the 420 MMJ Radio.
Hey, this is Scott from Rare Dangness. You're listening to Medical Marijuana Radio.
Okay, we're back. Let me bring Heather back and Jonathan back. Hi, Jonathan and Heather. We're back live on the air. And Heather, stand by for a second. What else would you like to get out? Obviously, you need to give out your Kickstarter and your website and stuff. What else in regards to your project would you like to tell the audience about tonight?
You know, I just think that it's a really important thing to start thinking about at this moment, because I go to the example of the Electoral College. You know, it's a really stupid, terribly unfair way to select a president.
Yes.
But once it got in place, it's really tough to remove. You know, that is the situation we're probably going to be facing with marijuana going forward. You know, if you don't really focus on certain nitty-gritty of getting the rules right early on, mm-hmm. you could easily be stuck with them for, 70, 80 years.
Right. It takes a long time to try to change rules. I mean, you know, this Schedule I thing's been going on since the 70s with Nixon, and I'm hoping that our President Obama and the current administration will do something before he leaves office to take that onus off of our industry.
Yeah.
So, Jonathan, why don't you go ahead and give out your Kickstarter page and any other contact information. How much are you trying to raise, and what is the deadline for you?
We're trying to raise $5,000. The deadline's the deadline is, I'm trying to remember what I put in. It's 10 days from now.
10 days.
And it's on Kickstarter. It's Project After Legalization by John Walker. And I write for Fire Dog Lake, where we run the Just Say Now campaign to promote, marijuana legalization.
Okay. And how much do you have so far?
We're at 2,000 at the moment.
So you need to a little bit over double right now in the next 10 days. So good luck with that. Keep us posted. And anytime you have anything you want to say, or when the book is ready to be released, let's have you on again and promote it and tell people where they can get it when it's out. So thank you for being our guest tonight. And I'll talk to you real soon, John.
All right. Sounds good. Thanks for having me on.
All righty. Heather. Heather, are you there, dear? Uh-oh. All right, let's hang on. Here we go. Hi, Heather, you're back on the air, dear?
Hello.
Hi, Heather. Heather Maness from Arizona and everywhere else. Heather, you've been on many times before, and this is, I know, not going to be a comfortable situation, but I really want to know. And I'd like you to tell the audience what happened the other day in Arizona.
Well, first of all, I think it's important to bring this story out because it's not just me that it's happening to. And as I was sitting there going through it, I was thinking of all the other patients who had experienced that themselves or were about, or, would experience it in the future. So my situation was such that we'd been traveling, as we do a lot, and, I'm in Arizona, legal patient, and we were coming from Yuma back to Tucson, and as we were driving through, there was a, we'd stopped in Yuma, we got some Subway sandwiches, and we were just happily eating and driving our way home, and we stumbled upon a checkpoint, and it's checkpoint 1155, and it's between Yuma and, on going toward Tucson. So we're driving by, I didn't think anything of it, and the dogs hit on us. And so they asked us to pull over, and so we did this whole time, knowing that I'm in the state of Arizona, I'm a legal patient, I have the right amount of medicine that I should have, I'm not doing anything wrong. They pull us over, and we follow what they ask us to do, and they ask us to, if we're legal resident, or if we're legal citizens of the U.S., and we said we were, and then they asked us to step out of the car. And so we did so, and they proceeded to search the vehicle, and they found my purse, which obviously had my medicine in it. And at that point, it was the only time that they asked anything about marijuana, and they said, "Do you have a medical marijuana card?" And I said, "Yes, absolutely. It's in my purse with my medicine," and so I went and got it for them. And this whole thing went on and on and on, and they brought the dog back in, and they searched all the entire car, and they came back with just this medicine that we had. And they said, we're going to take your medicine. And the whole time I was sitting there, I said, please don't take my medicine. As a patient that has a certain condition, you need certain strains for your condition, and it's not always easy to find, and you have to kind of accumulate your medicine cabinet when you're a cannabis patient. I said, please don't take my medicine. Those are the strains of medicine that I need for my condition. And they refused, and they said, you came onto a federal checkpoint. And I said, 5 feet back that way and 5 feet up this way, I'm a legal Arizona person. There's nothing, it wasn't until I came right here where you are that I'm now. And they said, this is a federal checkpoint. It's still illegal federally, and we're taking this medicine. If you were not a patient, we'd be taking you to jail. And I said, so you have this thought of mine to check to see if I'm a patient, and if I am, you just take my medicine, and if I'm not, I go to jail. And so in my mind, I'm thinking to myself, this is a scary experience. They're taking medicine that costs money. I know that I'm not the only patient this is happening to. Why are we allowing this in a legal state that it's legal there? Why are there specific little areas where if you happen to drive up on it, that you're going to get your medicine taken?
Now,
and so for me, it was a really disgusting experience to go through to think that a patient, if I was a seizure patient and I had my seizure medication and I drove, that they wouldn't do anything. What if I was a cancer or, a cancer patient or a seizure patient that was on cannabis?
Right.
And, they're taking this medicine from me and it's going to cause physical harm to me or another patient. It's just...
Let me add something here, okay? Obviously it's an upsetting situation. Being in the moment, it's hard to think clearly and how to respond to something like this. Hindsight is always, much better and easier to understand. But did you say anything to them as opposed, in regard to, let's say, the statement by Eric Holder in August that if you're following the your state's rules, they won't mess with patients?
Well, absolutely. And actually, I'd like Kenny to talk about that, because that's what he kept bringing up. He said, he asked them, have you read the Cole memo that came out in August? Did you read the Ogden memo that came out in 2009? Have you read these memos? And they said, oh, we don't know what you're talking about. We haven't read that. What do you mean you haven't read these things? They had some interesting comments for Ken. I'll pass off to Ken.
All right, thank you.
Hey, Larry, how's it going, man?
Doing okay, buddy. I'm sorry you guys had to live through this, but... I do want to talk to you a lot about it. Give me your thoughts. What I just said to Heather was, it's hard to, say the right thing in the moment because, you're upset. They're federal agents, blah, blah, blah. But bringing up that Cole memo and the Holder memo of August where they said we're not going to mess with patients who are abiding by the state's laws. So
exactly.
Go ahead.
Specifically. That up to each of the, they used a total of 5 or 6 different officers on the scene who wasted about an hour of their time and ours. And I asked each and every one of them who would listen to me, have you read the Ogden memo? We don't know what that is. No, it's only been out for 4 years and it's only issued by the Department of Justice, which, by the way, happens to be your boss.
Yes.
And they denied having read it. And the same with respect to the Cole memo. They denied having any knowledge about that. And so I tried to explain the essence of those to them, that they're basically there's no enforcement action against a patient who's in a regulated state legal marijuana system. Of course, we were coming from California and had our California recommendations as well as the Arizona regulations.
Yeah. Well, I wouldn't have mentioned that to them if I were you.
Well, the part of that is that if you look at the Cole memo, there's language in that says they're concerned about diversions to states that are not regulated.
Well, that's interesting that it's put that way. However, crossing a state line is the problem, right?
I think it's a worse problem. It's a more severe, it's a more insidious problem.
So
a problem.
Here's
the government
what I...
not by their own rules and their own policies.
Right. And of course, I think These federal agents sort of have their own rules and their own policies as well, because I know of two stories that we've talked about before here back in August, September, where federal agents saw some plants on some property, by helicopter, went there, brought agents with them, and they were both legal patients here in New Mexico, and they just, you know, ripped the plants up and took off, didn't charge them or anything. But that's, I guess it's maybe their last chance of trying to grasp some authority that has been taken away from them. But what I'd like to ask you guys to do, and I don't know if you want to or not, but there are instances where patients have gotten their medicine returned to them by legally going through some legal channels. Now, if it was me, I would probably try to go through and find out what happened to that medicine, what did they do with it, and I want it back. And I think that if you could get it back, it's going to set a precedent in your state that's going to help a hell of a lot of other patients. What do you think?
Well, we are doing that, as a matter of fact. I did supervisor's identification. We got an initial phone number to call into to try to get a copy of something, Form 41. Of course, I made the first call to the first number and spoke to a live, federal officer, who then gave me another phone number that, despite calling it a dozen times, nobody answers that phone. So I figured that's the game that they'll play.
It's probably his ex-wife's phone number.
Yeah, probably. And I'll probably, we have the intention at this point of writing to the U.S. attorney in Arizona and making our complaint known. We are going to request a copy of the form in which they're supposed to document the incident, and my plan is to file a Federal Tort Claims Act requiring them to either return the medicine or to pay damages for it.
Did you get a receipt for it?
They wouldn't give me anything more than the information that I could write down. And so the other thing is that, too, we could have insisted on them getting a search warrant. We didn't have to consent to the search. But the way that works out there is they can then detain you
for hours.
For hours to go to Phoenix or wherever the closest federal courthouse is to get a warrant.
See, it would be really interesting to me to discover a chain of evidence where it went from there, and if it went anywhere, or if those guys are having a good time. I'm glad that that you're going to pursue this, because again, I think that if you can set the precedent of getting your meds returned because you were legal in all aspects of it, I think that this confiscation, it needs to stop.
Absolutely, and we will. The U.S. attorney who was appointed last summer in Arizona is supposed to be a fairly progressive judicial officer, a former judicial officer. So I want to definitely communicate with him, especially this whole bogus claim by these Border Patrol people. They don't know what the Ogden memo is that they've been subject to for 4 years.
Have you gone to any publications yet?
I beg your pardon?
Have you gone to any newspapers or in regard to this story? Because I think that there's got to be a good reporter that wants to hop on this.
No, but we do have some media contacts. I did want to see if the U.S. attorney first would respond to a letter. That really was the first option, as well as tracking what happened in the medicine and getting their report. And so having that document is going to be, I think, at least helpful, maybe more informative to the media by having a response or lack of response from the U.S. attorney.
So I'm interested in knowing what the strains were that you had that Heather said specific.
Oh, you don't have those questions.
Oh, but I'll be happy to
talk. Oh, it breaks my heart, Larry. I cried and I had nightmares.
Oh, I'm sorry. But Ken, go ahead and tell me what they were, if you don't mind.
There were so many, but there was a super green crack that is possibly the best that I've ever had. And that was a very sad moment when to see that laying out on their table and then being put into a box. I was, definitely disheartened by that. But that was the thief among them. They were all good.
So is that a strain now that's lost to you, or the genetics around?
No, I do know how to trace those. I do know some sources, and in fact was speaking to someone who's a friend of mine who knows exactly where it is, and we'll make sure that there's at least some left over for us when we return.
Well, hopefully there's some genetics available where, you know, you can you can grow that out for your needs and so forth. What else is going? I'm sorry that you went through that. I interviewed 4 years ago Jacob White, who was working for SWAP at that time here in New Mexico. It was very early on, right when there was only maybe five producers, and he got stopped at the federal checkpoint, and they held him for like 8 or 9 or 10 hours, and really, scared him, and they took they took medicine from him as well. But that was like 2009, so it was really early.
Well, Larry, that's part of it too, is the fear factor and the scare tactic. You know, we just like he was part of the industry, worked in the industry. We work in the industry. You know, we're comfortable around being the medicine. We don't really think about it that much. And so when you're in a position like this and you're scared. All I could think of is how scared I was as a person who's used to this as being a risk,
right.
And think of being a patient, just a sick patient who needs their medicine. For me, when I was sitting there, I just thought, this is wrong. You know, how do other people respond to this extreme fear, this extreme, taking of their medicine when a lot of people don't have the financial ability to replace that? It just really puts a hardship on patients.
Right.
And just like they do it in New Mexico, the same deal, it needs to stop. I mean, there's no reason why, if we're in that legal state, that we can't be anywhere in that legal state.
Right.
With our medicine.
You know, there was a lot of news this week in regard to the federal government and the federal attorneys who scare the shit out of people. And get them to cop a plea as opposed to, going to court. They say, listen, we're going to give you 10 years for this, blah, blah, blah. And they force them, or else, if you cop a plea now, you'll be out in 3. And everybody gets so afraid that they take that. And Google it today. There's a whole thing going on this week about how they intimidate the federal government's attorneys intimidate people when it comes to drugs. There was an interview I saw. There's a man in Missouri who is in for life and he's been in for 20-something years already for having 5 pounds of marijuana 20 years ago, but he's still in jail. And he was saying that there are people that are murderers that are out now on parole. And he didn't murder anybody, and he's still in jail. So, there's a lot of intimidation that goes on with this. Now, we only have a couple minutes left. Anything new in Arizona that you want to tell us about as far as the 25-mile rule or the extract problem that's going on?
No changes other than the motion for preliminary injunction, as mentioned last time, had been filed, and a hearing date will soon be set. Which I would expect to either occur before the end of the year or just after it. And when that happens, I believe there will be an evidentiary hearing and most likely will prevail on that. At that point, law enforcement in the state will be directed not to intervene from legal dispensaries selling concentrates to their qualified patients.
Yeah, it's so important. The concentrates are so important. I mean, the oil... It's what's really helping a lot of people with so many different afflictions. So thank you for your hard work on getting that together, and keep us posted on that. Any final remarks about your stop?
Well, we're currently working on applications in Washington. So if anyone's interested, there's about 10 days left to get applications in there. 200 dispensary applications went in the first week. There's still another 134 before they get to a lottery, and there's several hundred other applications that are in there for production, growing, that is, and processing. So,
do you have to be a Washington State resident?
Yeah, you have to work through a Washington State resident.
Okay, so outsiders, people that are non-residents, can't apply for licensing for growing or dispensaries.
They can be involved.
They can be involved.
I'm working with clients right now, helping them to connect with the people who are residents in Washington and to get applications in for them.
What about Colorado? Is that limited to residents?
That also, the first round of the legal adult use was limited to residents, but I believe it's about 3 months or 6 months, I forget which it is, after that they'll do another round,
mm-hmm.
and at that point it may not be limited to residents, or at least won't be required to have been a medical dispensary first.
Gotcha. Yeah, well, you know, that whole thing in Washington has not been worked out yet. The liquor board wants to get rid of medical and just have recreational, and of course there's big stuff going on up there, and I would love to hear more about how that's going to turn out, because it's ridiculous to get rid of medical. The needs of the medical patients are different than the adult recreational. So medical must exist. It's very important.
Exactly. Yeah.
All right. Well, thanks very much for calling in. Again, I'm sorry that you got stopped. Next time, like I told Jacob, take the long way home and go around any known federal checkpoints. So thanks a lot. I'll talk to you guys very soon.
Thanks a lot, Larry. Have a great weekend. Good talking to you as always.
All right. Love you both. Bye-bye. We'll be right back.
The medical marijuana radio show.
The medical marijuana for you and me. Well, that was a little bit of a crazy show. We had a false start at the beginning. The network couldn't pick us up, but they're going to record our recorded version and get it up on iHeartRadio, TimeForHemp.com, and Spreaker, and everywhere else. Thanks for calling in, John Walker, and check out his Kickstarter campaign, After Legalization. Thank you, Heather and Ken. Thank you, my two radio mentors, both with the initials HS, and another one with two N's. That's a new one for me. We'll be back next Friday evening late at 11 p.m. Pacific, and again Saturday at 6 p.m. Pacific for Medical Marijuana Radio. Thank you very much for listening. Feel well. You can also email us at info@mmjradio.com if you have any suggestions for guests, topics, or just want to chew me out for being a bad broadcaster. info@mmjradio.com.
Shabbat. Shalom.
Good night, everybody. Feel well.